data properties to real-world applications. And I'm located at IFISC. This is the Institute for Interdisciplinary Physics and Complex Systems in Palma de Mallorca, Spain. The lecture that I'm showing today is based on the work of the group of the nonlinear photonics at IFISC, and mainly the work of Apostolos Algiris and Julián Bueno. Julián Bueno for the first part of the lecture and Apostolos for the second one. I have been working on this topic for several years now with other people in the group and also with some external collaborators like Laurent Larger and Daniel Brunner, who are in FEMTO. And all this work also has been done in collaboration with Ingo Fischer, who could not give the lecture today, so I'm here to replace him. So the context of the talk is, of course, in this school of machine learning photonics. One can understand machine learning and photonics in two ways. One, it is the use of machine learning for photonics, and then in the reverse scenario, it's the use of photonic systems for machine learning. And we are living exciting times now. And in particular, here I highlight several review articles that appeared in Nature Photonics, which is one of the leading scientific journals in the world, and also in particular in photonics, of course. In particular, for the first part of machine learning for photonics, one can think of using machine learning, for instance, deep learning, for the design of photonic structures. Another possibility is to use machine learning for applications in ultrafast photonics. This entails machine learning for photonics. On the other side, photonics for machine learning, you have this other review here, which is the use of photonics for artificial intelligence and neuromorphic computing. In the talk today, I will cover mostly the second part of using a photonic system for machine learning. And this is all also comes in a way motivated by the extensive use now of photonic integrated devices. So the fact that we have this technology available will make all these applications much more interesting in the coming years. In particular, an important opportunity for photonics comes by looking at this graph. This is a so-called hype cycle for semiconductor and electronics technologies, where we see which are the technologies that are currently emerging, and one of them is neuromorphic hardware. And here, for instance, photonics has a big role to play in the coming years. This talk is in the context of machine learning for photonics for machine learning, but the topic of machine learning that I will cover relates to artificial neural networks. In this sense, I would like to make a distinction between two types of artificial neural networks that you can see here in this slide, which are feed-forward network on the one side and recurrent networks on the other side. In both cases, there is some information that you want to process, and this comes here at the bottom on the input layer. In both cases, you have a hidden layer, which are the nodes that perform some nonlinear transformation of the input and give you the capability to do computations. And in both cases, there is an output layer where you collect the final responses and you give a prediction, you give an output related to the task that you have used to train the system. In the training or so-called learning, you change the connections from one layer to the other. And the difference comes from the fact that in feedforward networks, you have directed connections from the input to the output, while in recurrent networks, you have the possibility to form loops. And these loops create a so-called kind of memory, so-called fading memory, that allows the input to be processed in the context of previous inputs. And this is important. So this is important in this sense. It is known now that feedforward neural networks can approximate any continuous function. This comes from the universal approximation theorem, given an input from the input to the output. In contrast, recurrent neural networks can approximate dynamical systems. So you can have also the arrow of time in the network thanks to the memory provided in the hidden layer. You know, as an example of a practical task, for instance, to distinguish these two, one can think of a video activity recognition. Imagine you have such a video composed of several frames, and the target or the task is to see if this athlete is running or not, or it's a person that is walking. So for a recurrent network, you can give one frame at a time, one after the other, sequentially, to a recurrent network And since the input is processed, each input is processed in the context of the previous inputs, you can then get the estimation that this athlete is running. This comes naturally from a recurrent network because you can process sequential information. If you would like to do the same thing with a feed-forward network, it would not work just providing a single frame to the network. You would need to give the full sequence of frames, and then eventually maybe the network could learn that this person is running. But this doesn't have the sense of time. If you want to provide an input at a time, this you can only do with a recurrent network. So for the talk today, I will talk about ultrafast photonic information processing. I will need to introduce the concept of reservoir computing for that. And I will talk about fundamental properties of the system, in particular, the transient nonlinear dynamics of semiconductor lasers. And for the third part of the lecture, a real world application would be the recovery of an optical communication signal. So let's start with the reservoir computing. Reservoir computing is a concept that relates to recurrent neural networks with a further simplification that I will explain now. And this concept emerged in 2007, also coming from two different fields of liquid state machines and echo-state networks that conversed in this idea of reservoir computing. Reservoir computing, what it entails is that you have an input layer, a reservoir, which is you have here the computational nodes, nonlinear nodes, with recurrent connections, and an output layer. The particularity of reservoir computing is that the only thing that you need to train for a task is here the dashed lines that connect the reservoir to the output layer. All the other connections, for instance, the connections from the input to the reservoir or the connections inside the reservoir, you don't need to train. You can either pick it at random or initialized in some other way, but you need to optimize them during the learning. This possibility of leaving the reservoir untrained implies good suitability for hardware implementations, in particular in photonics. This is the topic of today, of today's lecture. In photonics, one can exploit some advantages of photonics hardware like speed, parallelism, and nonlinearities. In the context, before jumping into the topic of photonics, just to give you a flavor of what reservoir computing can do, this reservoir computing was a breakthrough in the context of recurrent neural networks for this simple and fast training that you only train the output connections without an apparent loss in computing power. In addition, you can have a simultaneous learning of multiple tasks. This is depicted here. Imagine you have some input, the response of the reservoir that you can read with different classifiers, different output layers. You can train all these different classifiers, different output layers independently, so you can do multiple tasks simultaneously from the same response of the reservoir. This is an advantage. In the context of machine learning, reservoir computing has been using for time series prediction, speech recognition, and financial forecasting, for instance, always involving this idea that you can process sequences. Photonic reservoir computing came more or less in 2008, the first idea. It followed by these works here in black. I highlight some numerical works on using a network of semiconductor optical amplifiers for photonic reservoir computing, also a network with photonic crystal structures. And later, it came the idea to use that could be demonstrated experimentally using a network passive components on a chip, like this picture here, or a network of diffractively coupled photonic nodes as depicted in this other slide here. So this has proven to be possible to do in photonics and useful to process sequential information. But I would like to cover now a different approach, not based on a network of connected photonic system, but on a minimal approach that we have been working at IFISC for several years now. And this comes from the... Now, and this, if you want to understand reservoir computing, what you need, the minimal ingredients that you need are some system that performs an Eulerian transformation, some reservoir that gives you a high-dimensional mapping of the input, and some reservoir that has this property of fading memory. If you build a system that has all these three minimal ingredients, then you can build a reservoir computer with it, photonic reservoir computer with it in particular. So the connection goes either, instead of using a traditional reservoir with multiple nodes, one can use a time, so-called time multiplex reservoir based on a single nonlinear node with delay, like depicted here, in which now the input comes through the nonlinear node and the computation can be done by measuring the response of the system at different times, something called that we call virtual nodes. And this can be used now for computation. So I will speak about this in a bit more detail now. And the topic of today's lecture is to use a semiconductor laser with optical feedback as the reservoir. So let's see how this works. This is the idea, is to use such a single node in a thanks to time multiplexing. The way one can process an input, I will explain it in two different ways. First, in the top, imagine you have a new sequential input that you want to process it with a single node. What you can do is to divide it in a, you can expand it in time, each of the inputs. For instance, the first instance of the input, you time multiplex to several time instances from one to n, that this will be later where we also read the response of the system that we call virtual nodes. The next to the next input of the sequence, we do the same, we expand it in time. All this goes, drives a nonlinear dynamical system that has a general equation like this that depends on the input and some state of the previous, also depends on the previous state of the system. Now we read the output, the response of the system, and also we can check the response at different instances of time. For the first instance, we collect the outputs at different times that we call here x0. If one, then the output comes from applying a set of weights, like is usually done in machine learning and artificial neural networks, a set of weights that we have learned in the training. So we give the system some examples, some tasks that we want to do, and with, for instance, a linear regression, one can compute the weights, these output weights. And the output comes from the applying the output weights to the responses of the system. The same can be done for the next instance of the input. You can generate the next output. Applying the same set of output weights to the new responses, you get the next output. In particular, what we are doing here is computation with nonlinear transient dynamics. Another way to look at it is now in, with this picture here below in time. Imagine you have a discrete input or a continuous input that you sample. Each of the instances of the input, we expand on the time period, we time multiplex on the time period of one input. We apply on it some modulation because we want to keep the system on a transient state. This modulation is repeated for every input and is something that can be learned at the output layer. All this information comes sequentially to drive the nonlinear node. We read the responses that depend on the input and also on the previous state of the system. In general, we keep the response of the system in this transient state, and nonlinear transients that we can use for computations. Let me repeat the same thing in words now. We have a time multiplexed input with random scalings that we allocate to different temporal slots to create the idea of virtual nodes. We have the sequential input that drives the nonlinear dynamical system, and the output is formed by a weighted sum of the virtual node states with trained weights. In a matrix version, one can write it in this form. Also, if you want, if you think of the more the natural way that you are measuring different instances of time, it is measuring the output of the system at different times and applying a different weight at each time, and at the end, making a sum of these values to get one output that depends on the, that relates to the initial input, one output at a time. So this was for the introduction of the system. And in particular, I will be looking at this system, at the, this photonic system, which is a semiconductor laser subject to a delay feedback loop where the information comes optically. So the single nonlinear node of the reservoir, it is a semiconductor laser here. The information comes externally as a modulation on top of an injection laser. It comes in this direction. This is the external information input. And the reservoir is made of the semiconductor laser subject to a delay feedback loop. in this system can compute, and for computation we just need to measure the output of the laser, detect it, and maybe do for some post-processing after detection. We call this ultra-fast photonic information processing because we have an input and information that comes at 20 gigasamples per second, and we measure these transient responses of the semiconductor laser by an oscilloscope with a speed of 80 gigasamples per second. The reservoir is, for instance, for the experiments that I will show you today, the reservoir is a discrete mode semiconductor laser working at 1542 nanometers with off-the-shelf telecom components, and the information will come from the optical injection in particular. One could also use some electrical injection, but I will not cover that today here. This is how one part of the experiment looks like in the lab. One could do these experiments in free space optics. Maybe one could also do them in photonic integration. For the moment, we have them here in a fiber-based setup where we have these components like attenuators, polarizers, the laser, all coupled with fibers. And these are the kind of systems that I will be discussing today. What can you do with them? So for instance, we did computation with this photonic system at gigabytes per second. For instance, the classification of spoken digits, speech recognition, in which we were doing simultaneously, in parallel, for some spoken digits, the recognition of the spoken digit with low errors, as well as the recognition of the speaker with low errors as well. You can do this in parallel because you can train different output layers coming from the same input and the same response of the laser. We have been also doing at IFISC the application of recovery of optical communication signals. This will be the second part of the lecture today, so I will go into data later. I don't need to explain it now. So how does it work? So I showed you that it works, that you can use it for information processing, but we want to have a better understanding of it. So what are the conditions for good performance? This I will go now in detail to show you how this can work and how we understand that it works actually from a dynamical systems perspective of this photonic system. This photonic system in the end, here I show the scheme again, it's a semiconductor laser, a subject to optical feedback that comes from this loop of light, and optical injection that comes from the external injection laser, and this has the external input that we want to process with the reservoir laser. Two of the most important dynamical parameters of the system are the feedback strength, that is how much light comes back to the laser that we can control with an optical attenuator here in this path, and also the frequency detuning. This frequency detuning, I'm referring to the difference in wavelength between the injection laser, that is the wavelength of the external input, and the wavelength of the response laser, of the semiconductor laser that is playing the role of the reservoir. So I will show how the performance of the system depends on these two important dynamical parameters. As a benchmark task, I will show I will focus on some general measures and a benchmark task. For the benchmark task, it will be a time series prediction. Something that you can do with recurrent neural networks is to predict the future, for instance, of a chaotic system. This Mackey-Glass model is a nonlinear dynamical system that produces a chaotic trajectory with these parameters. This is the representation of the chaotic attractor, and this is a representation of the time series. To use it in the context of reservoir computing, we sample this data and we inject it to the laser system with the mask and with the time multiplexing. We collect the output of the system and we apply some weights that we train for this task in particular, the prediction of one data point, one time step ahead in the future. So the target of the reservoir will be the input displaced by one point in the future. So it's a prediction task. I pick this task as a benchmark for today because this task requires memory of previous inputs and also the capability to approximate nonlinear functions. These are good properties that we need to have if we want to compute with this photonic system. I will also show you results for two general measures. The first of them is just a quantification of the memory that the system has. This is this task is called the memory capacity task and quantifies the short-term memory of any memory of the system. We want to know how much, what is the influence of previous inputs on the system, and how much, if we can recall them, how long we can record them from the current state. So let me show you an example here. Given an input that is a random time series, what you want to do is to collect from the response of this current, from the current response of the system, you want to ask the system to recall previous inputs that you are no longer seeing, so they are no longer the input of the system, but were sometime before. And this time is this this index I here, indicates the delay on the time of the input that you want to recall. Usually the memory function has this kind of shape as a function of the delay of how far are the inputs that you want to recall. It's kind one means that you are recalling very well, so you are very good. You have good memory of these inputs that are close in time. These are easier to recall, previous inputs that are close in time, but as time passes, as longer and longer, and you look into the past, you try to recall the past of the signal that is coming into the reservoir, it becomes more and more difficult to recover these values. That's why the memory curve has this shape, so-called fading memory. It's fading memory because at some point you cannot recall the values that were given to the system. And this memory capacity is the sum of all these individual memory values, so the area under this curve, if you like. And this memory capacity quantifies the capability to recall previous inputs from the current state of the reservoir. The other general measure that I would like to discuss today is a property of dynamical systems. Any reservoir should have this property, which is the property of consistency. It is the ability of a nonlinear system to respond in a similar manner to similar inputs. The idea is that you repeat the same drive signal to the nonlinear dynamical system, the laser in our case. We repeat it, the same signal, but starting from different initial conditions, which are arbitrarily chosen. We look at the responses from the same input signal, the response signal A, response signal B. If the system, the nonlinear system is consistent, you will see that after a short transient, the responses become equal. If you have this property, then we can say that the nonlinear dynamical system is consistent, and then we can use it for computation in the sense that you can learn from the responses, because the same input would always give you the same kind of responses, so you can generalize and use it for information processing. One way to quantify this consistency is by computing the correlation between the different responses to the same input. A high correlation between these responses would mean high consistency, low correlation between different responses to the same input would imply low consistency. So let's have a look at the dynamical system that we have here. This is the photonic system of the laser with feedback and injection. We can characterize this system by looking at the optical spectra of the system, for instance. This is shown here. This is the optical spectrum as a function of the frequency. And here I point the two signals that are coming that are involved in the processing. This is the injection, so this is the external input that we want to process. Here we shift it in frequency that we can see it, that we can see properly. And this other gray line, it is the response of the laser with feedback. This is the natural dynamical response of the laser, semiconductor laser with feedback in the absence of input. So we want to see the interplay between the natural dynamics of the laser, which is this peak here, and the external information depicted by this other peak. If one injects this external information into the semiconductor laser, depending on the distance between the frequency of the external laser and the frequency of the response laser, this detuning, one can have three different scenarios, coming from fully locked, partially locked, and unlocked. So I will start by discussing the extremes. In the case of a fully locked scenario, this is the lighter color. we have a single peak, we measure a single peak in the optical spectrum, and that is that this means that the response of the system is fully locked, meaning that it has kind of copied the input, the frequency of the input. In this sense, the reservoir or the reservoir laser is just following the input. In the other extreme case, we have the scenario of an unlocked situation. In an unlocked situation, when the frequency between this frequency between the laser and the injection laser and the response laser is they are very far apart. Zero denotes the frequency of the response laser of the one that we use for the reservoir. If this distance is very high, these optical frequencies do not see each other, they do not talk to each other. So we see in the two independent components, which is the external input and the natural dynamics of the laser, but we cannot use it probably. Well, I don't want to anticipate, but we will see that this is not useful for information processing. In the intermediate case, partially locked, we find this situation where the distance in frequency between these two spectral lines is in kind of intermediate, in the other 20 gigahertz in this example. And we see that the natural dynamics of the laser now it's kind of attenuated. And one can understand this, I will show it in a different way now in the temporal domain, but this we can understand this optical spectrum as the response laser having this interplay between trying to follow the external input and also having its own internal dynamics. So this scenario of full locking and partial locking and unlocking can be characterized as I did here, as a function of the frequency detuning, also as a function of the feedback strength. So the feedback strength gives you how much the role of internal dynamics is important for the response of the reservoir. In this picture here, the stronger feedback would be here at the bottom and a strong attenuation of the feedback, so no feedback at the top. We find that the partial locking occurs at the boundary between the unlocking region and the full locking region. And we'll see that this has consequences for the information processing. So this is now the results that I will show you now results that Julian Bueno obtained in the lab for the system. This is the laser optically driven with the input from the Mackie glass time series. What you are seeing in this slide is the superposition of hundreds of responses to the same input for the three scenarios of small detuning, intermediate detuning, and large detuning. The reservoir laser has a feedback, a delay feedback of 66 nanoseconds. That means that we have 330 virtual nodes in this case. So looking at the responses, if the tuning is small, we find at times if we overlap, superimpose many responses to the same input, and we plot them on top of each other, we see that they have a kind of a well-defined profile. So the locking means that the input provides the same output, so to say. In the intermediate case, in the partial locking scenario for intermediate detunings, frequency detunings, we find this idea that some parts, it's a dynamical picture, some parts of the time series gives a blurred response. This is the part where the internal dynamics of the laser takes over, and some other parts of the dynamics where the external input dominates and the response has a well-defined trajectory. And for large detunings, we see that the responses are not, these are kind of a measure of consistency. They are not consistent to each other. They have a wide distribution when you measure many different responses to the same input. So this is just that you have an impression of what this consistency measure means. Now for the results, the input comes at an injection rate of 5 gigasamples per second, for instance, the input is the Mackie glass input generated for the Mackie glass model. Here, this plot as a function of, I will be using these diagrams as a function of the frequency detuning and the frequency strength of the feedback. In this case, consistency correlation, light color means a good consistency, something that you would like to have. It's a good property to have. We find the highest consistency for low feedback rates because the feedback has some destabilizing effect. For higher feedback rates, the highest consistency we find for these small detunings. So this is a property we need to keep in mind for the when we want to understand the results for the task. Another general measure is the memory. Now I show you the memory capacity that I introduced earlier. In this case, the darker, the better. So a good memory here, it's a dark color. In this representation, we find that the best memory comes from a strong feedback and intermediate frequency detunings. In this case, the input is a random sequence, so the memory only comes from the reservoir. We see that different configurations of frequency tuning and feedback have different properties. So in principle, one can optimize these properties for the task and one can control this for the task. So now this is the benchmark that I wanted to show. So this is the prediction of the chaotic signal. Here now in color, I represent normalized mean square error of the task. And light color means high error, darker color means a low error. So in this case, we want to have a dark color in this representation of feedback and frequency detuning. The task, as I said before, was the prediction of the Nernst value for Mackey-Glass chaotic time series. We find the best performance here for this intermediate frequency detuning and strong feedback. So how can we understand these results? If we look at the three things together, so these general measures, the consistency, the memory together with the prediction for a given task, we find that the best prediction properties of the reservoir, that are in this region here, the dark colors, come as a compromise between having a good consistency, that would be this part here, but also a good memory. You need the memory for the task, you need the consistency for the task, so where you have compromise between the two, you find the best performance here. So on the closing remark for this part of understanding the fundamental properties would be that tailoring the laser dynamics is key for optimal operation on this ultra-fast photonic information processing system. This region dynamically coincides with where we have this partial locking in the dynamics. We also tried this for a faster input rate of 20 gigasamples per second. Here, just as a summary, I show you the three plots of the general measures, the consistency, the memory capacity, and the error. And also for this speed, for this higher input rate, we find that the best performance, the lowest error, comes at the transition, at the boundary between full locking and unlocking, where we have the partial locking. This is for 20 gigasamples per second. We have now the capability for even a further speed up of the system. We have a new instrumentation that can go up to 92 gigasamples per second in the input generation. So we are excited about that. And with this, I close the first two parts of the lecture, and I will now in the remaining 10 minutes, I will cover the real world application of recovery of optical communication signal. Sorry. So context for the task. As you may know, fiber-based optical communications are the backbone behind these modern types of communications that we are using today. And usually the target is to achieve to send as much data as possible, as fast as possible, and over the longest distances. In this case of fiber transmission, the nonlinearity comes as a also gives this nonlinearity of the fiber transmission medium may limit the communication speed and distance. This will be, and one can use a reservoir computer to try to mitigate this nonlinearity. Usually there are two strategies to go around the nonlinearity. One is to launch on the fiber a low optical power. In this case, you may have high bit error rate due to noise because of stochastic effects when you increase the distance of the propagation. The other strategy you want to have a high signal to noise ratio is to launch a high optical power into the fiber, but then due to the fiber transmission nonlinearities, one can also get a high error rate, a high bit error rate. But this is a deterministic effect, so maybe we can do something about it. In fact, contemporary ultra-fast digital signal processors can be efficient up to some point where the nonlinear transformation is not too complex. So the aim of this last part of the lecture is to study how one can mitigate these deterministic effects using an analog photonic reservoir computer. The example would be the transmission of an optical signal over an optical fiber. Usually in this kind of system, one shows an eye diagram of the transmission to identify how good the transmission is. Eye diagram means, in this simple example, two levels of zeros and ones that are transmitted over the fiber. They are well distinguishable. As the transmission along the fiber increases, the eye diagram closes. That means that the zeros and the ones become more difficult to distinguish. And eventually, if the distance increases for too much, the eye closes and you cannot tell the bits one from each other anymore. This is usually represented as with a measure of bit error rate, how many mistakes, how many errors you make in the transmission. And it is known that there is a hard threshold for forward error connection. If you are above this bit error rate, you cannot recover the original signal anymore. So in this particular example, that the transmission suffers from chromatic dispersion and surface modulation, then transmission could only be limited to less than 20 kilometers. This is just an example. It comes from numerical simulations of the transmission over the fiber with the Schrödinger equation. So the questions that we want to tackle here are, can we efficiently work in presence of linear and nonlinear fiber impairments and improve detection performance? Can we extend the communication distance of the various fiber-based communication systems? We want to answer this by considering a hardware photonic reservoir computer and by converting the standard array detection process into a pattern recognition problem. So let me give you some details about this. Now we will tackle the problem of reconstructing a signal at the end of the transmission, at the end of the fiber, at the end of the transmission line. So in this case, the input after the transmission, we understand that this is an analog pattern that we sample at different times. So let me go back. We sample at different times. We apply a different mask, a different weight to each of these samples of the analog pattern. This information we send sequentially to our reservoir, photonic reservoir, which is the laser with feedback. We measure the response and we train a classifier to predict the values of the bits that relate to the input only given the output. Since the transmission now is on the fiber and you have chromatic dispersion, neighboring bits influences also carry some information for the extraction of the bits. So let's look at this with some example. Imagine this is an example of a short-reach no return to zero transmission, the result of a 25 gigabits per second at 45 kilometers with array detection. The eye diagram would look very close. Since this data comes from data we know, we can separate the ones and the zeros, build a histogram for them. We see that we find a strong overlap with the responses at the end of the transmission, the responses of the one, and let's say the output of the fiber for the ones and for the zeros. Here the bit error rate for direct detection is very bad, 0.1. So we want like to do something about it with the reservoir computer. And for that, we need to understand something, which is that actually the response that we collect at the output of the fiber depends on the history of the signal. So if we want to understand what is the output of the fiber for a given bit, we need to know if we compare this response at the end of the fiber for different neighboring bits, for instance 0, 1, 1 here and 1, x6, where we change these two, the values of these two bits between 0 and 1, we find that this actually gives us different patterns at the output along the bit duration that are distinguishable to each other. So we can translate the transmission now at the output from a, to a pattern recognition problem that we can tackle with machine learning to identify these patterns that come from the different bit sequences. We will consider different numbers of neighboring bits for the computation in the future and in the past to analyze, to recover the current bit. And we'll use this multi-bit training in the linear classifier with a perceptron, which is the photonic reservoir. As a comparison of the results, one needs to keep in mind that we are doing several steps and would like to identify that the advantage comes from the photonic reservoir and not from the procedure. The procedure is to take the analog signal, sample it, apply some weights to it, consider several bits, the neighboring bits, and compute a linear classifier out of it, but without the reservoir. So the same procedure without the reservoir, this will be our benchmark to see if the reservoir, the photonic reservoir, is doing something or not. So the application now, the results I'm going to show, is for a fiber transmission of a PM4 data encoding, 27 kilometers of transmission at 56 gigabit per second, the rate, with the optical power launched into the fiber is 10 dBm. This signal is injected into the reservoir, and we want to process it with the same configuration that I showed you earlier in the part of the fundamental aspects. We want to collect the responses of the reservoir and see if we can process this external information that is coming from the fiber transmission. One of the good things is of the photonic reservoir, that is the laser with feedback, is that we understand it well. We have a good model for it. So I will show you now numerical results of the so-called Lanko-Bayes equations that describe this photonic system of the laser subject to a feedback loop. These are the results now. So these results have been obtained by Apostolos Akiris in the lab of the nonlinear photonics at IFISC. The semiconductor laser on the reservoir is fixed at threshold, and we play, as in the part of the fundamental properties, we will play with this these properties that affect the dynamics, which are the laser frequency detuning. This is the detuning between the injection laser and the semiconductor laser of the reservoir, and the feedback strength. We will evaluate the bit error rate after linear regression, considering 20 bits as the sequence to train. We train this for a time series of 2 to 18 bits, considering that we have two levels that we need to consider. The benchmark that comes from doing all the procedure without the photonic reservoir, from the linear regression only, is give us a bit error rate for the signals of 0.037. In this picture of the bit error rate, linear regression corresponds to this. We also need to consider what are the hard threshold for forward error connection, that is 3.8 × 10⁻³, is this line here. So we want to be better than that with the photonic reservoir. Let's see if this is possible. And this is shown in this diagram here as a function of the feedback parameter and the frequency detuning. Indeed, we find two regions of good operation. This is the dark red color here with low bit error rates. And in particular, we find a bit error rate of 2 × 10⁻³ in this area, so below the threshold for forward error correction. And interestingly, we recover the result that we got from the study fundamental properties. The best results occur when we find this operation of partial locking. So the partial locking conditions between the injected optical carrier and the reservoir optical emission favor the most efficient processing because we have the highest internal memory in the photonic reservoir. So we have this balance of the system trying to follow the external input, at the same time having some natural dynamics that give us memory. So in this balance of partial locking, we find the best results. So I would like to conclude the part of the results with this slide. In the comparison of the linear regression and the photonic reservoir computer, we see that considering 20 bits, you don't need to consider more than that, and that you get a kind of more than one order of magnitude improvement in this representation. But in other conditions, here, this is the bit error rate dependence on the optical power launched into the fiber, that you get, this gives you a better optical signal to noise ratio. The signal for the results is again the transmission over 27 kilometers of fiber at a speed of 56 gigabit per second. We find the best performance of the reservoir and a good improvement over the benchmark, which is just the linear regression over the data, for these conditions of 5 to 10 dBm injected into the optical fiber. So indeed, the reservoir computer post-processing or the reservoir computer decoder manages to mitigate partly the transmission effects. So we have a bit error rate below the hard threshold for forward error connection. So by considering, as a take-home message of this part, by considering nonlinear distorted signals from simple PAM4 fiber optic transmission systems, we achieve a bit error improvement up to two orders of magnitude. I show you in this second part, I show you this comes from numerical results, but we also have experimental results that validate this approach. And you can find it in these references here below if you are interested. And with this, I would like to end this lecture today with a summary. The summary is, I show you today that machine learning methods with arbitrary mappings find a natural home in hardware implementations, that semiconductor lasers coupled with optical feedback offer a minimal approach to implement machine learning in photonics, that time multiplex photonic systems have proven to be a versatile platform for reservoir computing, and in the end, for the application, photonic reservoir computer as an efficient tool for post-processing decoding ultrafast signals. You will hear more about photonic reservoir computing in the talk of Daniel Brunner, probably from a different perspective of the one I gave you today. I would like to tell you that we have a book on photonic reservoir computing that we edited 2 years ago, where you can find more information about the topic if you're interested. And if you allow me, I would like to end the lecture by making an announcement, which is the organization of a workshop on deep learning in unconventional neuromorphic hardware that maybe you may find interesting for your results as well. And the workshop will take place in July of this year, and the abstract submission is the 30th of April. And with this, I close and thank you for the attention.
Thank you so much, Miguel, for your...